Welcome to Faces, your medical and surgical guide to the head and neck. Saliva is a multi-faced body fluid. Moisturizing the oral cavity, saliva has an essential role in initiating the digestion process and acting as a food lubricant to help swallowing. It modulates food taste and aromatic sensitivity. It helps to protect against tooth decay, has antibacterial and antifungal functions, helping to regulate oral flora, important in avoiding bad breath. And not the least, to moisture those French kisses. Welcome to this video, where I'll talk about saliva and the salivary glands, what they are, the most common disorders, how to approach them, and a few curiosities about this important fluid. Saliva is produced and secreted by the salivary glands. These are classified into major and minor glands. There are six major salivary glands, three on each side of the face. The largest are the parotid glands, located in front of the ears. Then the submandibular glands represent the second largest glands and can be found beneath the floor of the mouth. Anteriorly to them lie the sublingual glands. There are around 800 minor salivary glands throughout the aerodigestive tract, but most are concentrated in the buccal mucosa, lips, and tongue. During sleep, the rate of saliva flow is lower, and that is one of the explanations for the typical disagreeable morning breath. Saliva is mainly comprised of water, proteins, ions, and enzymes. Salivary flow can be disrupted, and saliva may get retained and collected inside the cyst, creating a mucocele. They usually occur in the minor salivary glands of the lip and cheek mucosa. It may also leak through the floor mouth tissues, appearing as a large, translucent swelling, resembling the belly of a frog, therefore called ranula. In young ages, mucoceles and ranulas tend to resolve spontaneously, but if they are symptomatic, persistent, and are not self-resolving, they can be surgically managed. Salivary flow can also be interrupted by a stone. Yep, salivary glands can form stones sharing some similarities to kidney stones. It usually happens in the submandibular gland because the highly viscous saliva from this gland flows against gravity, stagnating more easily and contributing to ion precipitation. It may also occur in the parotid gland or any salivary gland. In these cases, the gland size may fluctuate. It rises suddenly during meal times when there is a saliva stimulus, but no drainage due to the mechanical blockage caused by the calculus. Then, in between meal times, the size tends to reduce partially. Stones may be expelled on their own, but sometimes they need a surgical intervention, either with local or general anesthesia, occasionally using an endoscope if the calculus location is favorable for that method. Tumors. Tumors originating from salivary glands are usually benign, presenting more frequently in the parotid gland as a solid, slow-growing lump. Pay attention, do not disregard benign tumors, as some types of benign tumors carry a considerable risk for malignant transformation. A painful, fast-growing lump, neck nodal lump, and facial paralysis are some red alert signals pointing toward a possible malignant mass. The smaller the size of the salivary gland, the higher the probability of a malignant tumor. The usual diagnostic workflow includes imaging exam and a fine needle aspiration. Surgery is the mainstay therapy. One of the main concerns is to preserve the facial nerve structure and function, not only the submandibular, but in particular in the parotid gland. Because the nerve crosses the gland interior, it therefore requires a high level of expertise to remove the tumor, preserving all nerve ramifications as far as possible. In malignant cases, surgery might have to include the resection of neck lymph nodes. Radiotherapy is also a main or complementary treatment option. This is the case of a 69-year-old man with a big right-sided face mass. The diagnostic workout included a fine needle aspiration exam and imaging exam. The surgical procedure started with a classical incision just in front of the earlobe, extending to the neck. Then, the skin was separated from the rest of the tissues. After, the facial nerve was identified and carefully separated from the tumor. All nerve ramifications were preserved. After 3 years of follow-up, he's still under close clinical monitoring, with no signs of relapse or neck metastasis. He has full facial nerve functionality, a pain-free and full autonomous life. So, you've seen the usages of saliva, the glands responsible for its production, some of salivary glands diseases, and a take-home message not to disregard salivary gland tumors even when they are benign. I hope you enjoyed the video, and thank you for watching.